I'm live. Hey. I just would like to greet you and welcome you. Happy Easter, everybody. Isn't it a wonderful day to be in church? I have a few announcements. The pastor's post, so the newsletter, is out in the narthex if you haven't gotten that. You can also look at that online. I want to share with you that just a few days ago, there were some special birthdays, like James Garner had a birthday on April 7th. Jackie Chan. Jackie Chan is one of my favorite, I don't know if you want to call him an actor, but I think he's pretty cool. He had a birthday April 7th. But my all-time favorite person, Debbie in the back, had a birthday on April 7th. So you know that the Christian Family Homeschool has been using our building for the last several months, and it's really cool to see 100 extra people in here on a weekday, and they're here every Thursday. But they've invited us to a recital, so I want you to mark your calendar, highlight it in your bulletin, whatever it takes to get you here. But April 22nd, it's a Saturday, at 1 p.m. in the sanctuary here, they're going to have a recital and refreshments to follow. And I think it'd be pretty cool to support them and let them know how much we appreciate them bringing so much life into this building. There's a change. So if you are used to coming to Bible study here on Wednesdays at 10:30 in the morning, if you come in this Wednesday and the sanctuary is empty, it's because the Bible study is going to be in the chapel. So we christened the chapel this morning. It really looks great. And we're going to start doing Bible study up there. If you need help with the stairs or that doesn't work for you, please let me know, and we can go back to having it in here or wherever you're comfortable, okay? Special announcement, next Sunday, and I cannot, because it's a surprise, I can't tell you all the details. What I'm going to tell you is be prepared to be hungry after service and don't run out of here. All I can tell you is that. Come hungry for something after church. But there's a surprise. Cliff?
We have carpet, so there'll be some activities.
Yes. So, the dumpster outside the building, the entrance this morning, is not an Easter decoration. They start carpeting tomorrow, so they're going to, everything on this first floor and in the education area, except for the sanctuary, is going to be recarpeted. We're getting new carpet. So that's where the old carpet will be. And I expect it to be like that for most of the week. This is going to be a lot of activity out here, and it'll be torn up. But we'll get through the week, and then we'll have new carpet. Jeff, anything? Debbie? Let's worship. I invite you to stand for our call to worship, please. These words come to us from Psalm 16. Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I said, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. Lord, you have assigned my portion and my cup. You have made me secure. You have placed me in a pleasant place, and my inheritance is in you. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord before me. Because the Lord is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. My heart is glad. My tongue rejoices because you will not abandon me to the grave. You make known the path of life. Alleluia. So we're going to sing our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today. And so we had a choir leader this morning in the sunrise service. Elizabeth is here with us. And we got stuck, and at one point, she just started. So without Lexi being here, we may have to rely on Elizabeth to get us gone, but I think we're going to do okay. Sing loud and clear, Christ the Lord is risen today. I'm anxious to hear what praises and prayer concerns are on your heart this morning. Yes.
My cousin Cindy has been able to spend spring break with Jamie teaching her how to ride a bike.
Awesome. That is good news. How many times have you fallen? Like three times? That's not too bad. That's pretty good. Are you having fun? Good.
Jeff? Your grandson turned two yesterday?
Karen?
Pike
turned two. Okay. That's pretty good news. How's he doing with that?
I think he's adjusted to it.
Is he doing okay? All right. Yeah, mom and dad not so much, but he's doing great.
Remember my sister-in-law, Marty? She's in the hospital now. She had a diverticulitis attack, so I'm not sure how long she'll be there.
So had knee issues, now diverticulitis. Okay. Keep her in prayer. So we do have a pastor's prayer team. And I send out announcements frequently of different people needing prayer that I become aware of. But I want everyone to know.
No, this is, it's pastor's prayer team, but it's not my prayer concerns. It's our prayer concerns. and it's a way for you to quickly reach me. So if you have a prayer concern, if you have a praise that you want lifted up, and it happens at a crazy hour or the middle of the week or something, that's your best way to reach me and to get prayer immediately. Because as soon as I get that from you, I make sure that everyone gets that prayer concern. So don't think that it's just there for me to put things on the prayer chain. Please reach out and use that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we are most blessed this morning. The fact that we get to be here and worship freely. We look into an empty tomb and we are amazed because it means that you are risen. You are our Lord. You are a Savior. How blessed we are. It's hard for us to comprehend the kind of love that you have for us, but Lord, we are so grateful. We are so blessed. Lord, hear us now as we pray. No, on the Lord's Prayer. I'm sorry. Lord, we ask that you would lead us into this time of prayer and quietness, and that we would just be with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd ask that you stand for our doxology, please. Lord, we ask that you would accept our gifts of tithe and offering, that it be represented of how much love we have for you, that we want to return the blessings that you've given us. Lord, we ask that you multiply them to serve your kingdom, both here on earth and in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Okay, Robert, I'm going to cue you when it's time. Not yet. So there are three important words that I want to share with you. Do you know what the three most important words are that we could know about this Easter Sunday? Colton, got any idea? Okay, we're going to count. See Robert up there? Wave, Robert. There, see Robert? We're going to count to three. And in three, he's going to put three important words on the screen. Can you watch with me? Okay, can you count with me? One, two, three. What's it say? He is risen. Those are the most important words we could know about being Christian. Without those three words, then that means we're still sinners. Because Jesus died, but his resurrection is what frees us, what makes us sin-free and welcomed into heaven. So those are the three most important words. But if I just say that, what is the church supposed to do? Do you know what they do? Because we give them the introduction. We say, he is risen. Now, those of you that know it, I want you to shout it out. So they're going to shout real loud. So we're going to start with three words. What are our words? He's risen. So watch this. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. See, didn't that work well? We say he is risen, and they say he is risen indeed. It's important because Jesus rose from the dead means that he's defeated sin. And he's defeated death, And he has the victory. And when we're in him and he's in us, we win too. So that's why those are three so important words. He is risen indeed, okay? So, or he is risen. So are we having children's church? So Mary's back there and she's going to take you. But before we do that, let's have a quick prayer. Dear Lord, I just thank you so much for these children that are here and those that are watching online and those of us who are blessed enough to be celebrating our second and third childhood. Lord, we pray so much that you would just continue to guide us, that you would love us as you have loved us, and that we might be your children. Help us to love others as you do, and just remind us how important it is to remember how much you love us. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, glad you're here.
Today's scripture from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the disciple Jesus loved and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and John ran to the tomb. John bent over and looked in at the strips of linen laying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she looked into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." She turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was a gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So I want you to notice something. This is the wheelbarrow that had our stones. Here all Lenten season, we were throwing stones in it, representing our sin. This morning, the wheelbarrow has no stones. As a matter of fact, flowers are now coming out of that wheelbarrow. You see, when the stone was rolled away and the tomb was found to be empty, your sins and my sins disappeared. They're not held in a bank. If you ever mess up again, they come back. Your sins have been erased. They're destroyed. They don't exist anymore. Where there was sin, grace resides now. In preparing for this message, I don't want to be solemn, but I want to be serious. I use analogies a lot. The only one that came to mind that fit was about buying a new house. So you're going to hear some analogies in here about buying a house today and what that might look like. I don't mean it to be disrespectful. I tried to come up with a different kind of analogy and I couldn't. So that's where we are today. That's the story you're going to hear. And I hope that it makes sense and you get a sense of understanding where I'm coming from. But let's pray first. Dear God, we step into an empty tomb to see, to hear, and to experience new life. Christ is risen, changes everything. We're new creations. We are an Easter people, but we're an eternal Easter people. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts would please you. Amen. So if you weren't here at the sunrise service this morning, I kind of led us on a quiet walk into the garden and what that might have been like for Mary. You know, it's the garden where Jesus was buried and the breeze was blowing gently through the trees. Birds chirped and sang out their music. And angels' wings fluttered. I mean, think about it. But this feels different to me. It's a couple of hours later. I imagine that Mary, several hours into her day after meeting Jesus, her day is now different. It's not a quiet garden anymore. So I'm not thinking that we should be all that quiet. As a matter of fact, there was just an earthquake as the stone was rolled away from the tomb. And actually, the stone lay broken on the ground. Other stones were torn from their settings. The sins that shamed us and stained us and weighted us down don't exist anymore. They're not anywhere. They disappeared with the dawn of the new day, a new creation, a day of resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's our day of salvation. My message to you over these past weeks was about Lent and how the stones became commandment stones. They're ways of living that we had not followed through on. They're contrary to how we were supposed to live. Some of us got used to throwing stones over the years. Look back at remember the stones that would cry out on Palm Sunday if the children didn't sing praises to Jesus? Remember Jesus' miracle of turning water into wine with the 6 stone jars? Remember how Jesus transforms hearts of stone? Think about that. And then this morning we have the rolling stone. Not the plural rolling stones, but we have the rolling stone. Today's message has 3 main characters I want us to think about. I want us to think about Mary and John and Peter. Where do they fit in? How do we align with where they were in their faith journey at the time? Mary went to the tomb, but she looked from a distance. Close enough to see, but not close enough yet. A little standoffish. And then we meet John. He was close enough to investigate from a distance, but he's still a little bit tenuous. And then we get to brash Peter. Oh my gosh, here comes Peter. He's bringing up the rear, but he's the first one in the tomb. He goes all the way in. He's got to see this. He is the Peter bull in a china shop. Who are you? Which one best describes you? These identities, these 3 people have different degrees of faith, different maturity. They've suffered different setbacks of faith, and then they turn to God in faith. Kind of sounds like us, doesn't it? Who we are is probably more of a timing question. One day we're more like Mary, another day like John, another day like Peter. Or we go through a day where we're all three of them mixed up. I'd like us to consider ways that we can be stronger in our faith for lengthier time periods. Instead of being close to Christ for a few minutes, can we extend that? Can we pass on those good traits to friends or family members? So let's take a look from an Easter perspective at our faith and how the stone being rolled away affects us. Are we Mary? Are we cautiously faithful? Are we John? We're at the front of the parade, but we're a little bit hesitant. We're not quite discerning yet. Or are we Peter? We rush in where angels even fear to tread and kind of slow to figure things out. Where are we? Let's look at Mary first. Wonderfully faithful, but so uncertain. I want to confess to you right now that these are my interpretations. And if I ever need to apologize to Mary, John, or Peter, I most definitely will. This is my interpretation for a teaching moment. And I could be completely off base. I'm just using these examples as I read the scripture, how I might have interpreted what happened here. And if I've misstated anything, I do apologize to them. But have you ever tentatively unwrapped a gift that you assumed was exactly what you asked for? If it's shaped like this, and you asked for a horse, I think you might have gotten what you had wished for. You might be okay. But if this is what you really wanted, it's a little different. Not quite the same amount of horsepower here. You could have reason to be reluctant in unwrapping the gift. Mary, on her first visit to the tomb, saw that the stone was rolled away, and she didn't recognize the gift. She hot-footed it back to Peter and told the other disciples what she had witnessed. Now, new Christians and some of us more mature Christians at one time or another are Mary. Yep, I see it's a gift, but I don't know. I'm going to call in reinforcements. We're a little hesitant. We want to bounce our perspective off of somebody else. We want someone else's input. In these moments, we absolutely, completely, maybe, are partway in. We got one foot there, but I'm not sure. Mary holds back a little bit. We're convinced, but. It's like putting a contract on a house. So here's where we start into the house buying analogy. You're absolutely convinced you're making the right decision. It's the best decision until it comes to signing your name on that bottom line. Been there? You're convinced, pen in hand. See, Mary knew beyond all doubt what she was going to find. Okay? She was going to find a sealed tomb. Stone in place, Roman guards on duty. That's what she expected to find. Now, we're buying a house. We know what we're going to find, except we get to the signing and we find out, along with the tons of paper that we expect to sign, the agreed upon sale price and the agreed upon interest rate. But then things are different. You see, Mary gets to the tomb, and it's nothing like what she expected. The stone's been rolled away. The Roman guards are running like scared kids. They're just beside themselves with fear. So now she's reluctant to move forward because it's not what she expected. What you weren't counting on as you sit at the closing table, pen in hand, is something shows up on the paperwork. There's an easement in the house that you're planning on buying. Sits right on the edge of a new thoroughfare that is going to be going through your subdivision, linking two cul-de-sacs with a major highway. It's still the same house. Nothing's changed. Still the same year note, same agreed upon price, same interest rate. It's a big moment. But do you want to put that pen to paper? Do you feel like definitely maybe? So let's look at Peter. I want to know, and I don't have any way of knowing right now, was Peter in a foot race with John? Did Peter, was he older? Did he have a few more pounds on him? Scripture tells us that John got there first. They left at the same time. John got there first. I'm guessing that John was in better shape. That's my interpretation. But John waits for Peter. You see, John ran ahead, but then he stops. Why did he stop? Was it because he felt like Peter was their appointed leader now, and it was out of respect? Or was maybe John a little more reluctant by nature? Or no particular reason. John just waited. He didn't know what to do. Peter's brash. He's bold. He's the type that would be pushing to the front of the line even if he didn't know what he was getting in line for. Peter's just got to be there pushing. If we look at home buyers, maybe Peter is the guy who sees without fully comprehending. Peter charges in. He gets the price. He gets the major points. He gets everything is satisfied. He puts a deposit on the house, and later he discovers that it needs a new roof. And the neighbors, well, I'll just say they're just a little bit different. How many times have we run ahead in a situation when what we should be doing is taking our time and observing and discerning and practicing, thinking things through? When there's a car breaking down on us or bearing down on us in a crosswalk, that is not the time to slow down. The brain skips the frontal lobe and says, get out of the way now. There's no thinking going on. Feet are moving before the brain engages. Don't try to outguess the driver's intentions or state of mind or what he could be doing. Move. See, sometimes we make rash decisions that aren't good, though. We get married before we're ready. We make employment decisions or purchases. All kinds of situations where we don't think rationally sometimes. We make emotional decisions with little investigation for what is real or is important. Peter ran ahead. He goes right into the tomb. If there were angels outside of the tomb, I doubt Peter would have seen them. He runs into the tomb, and then John follows him in, and then Scripture says that John saw and believed. But what about Peter? Peter was first in. John, who was a little hesitant like Mary, follows Peter in, and John saw and believed. His discernment kicked in. I think Peter's processing. Peter hasn't put it together yet. And as I said, this may or may not be accurate. I have no idea. And I'm not going to claim that I do. This is my perception of what might have happened on that first Easter, that Easter Sunday. I also believe that Peter was conflicted. He wanted desperately to understand, to make sense of what he was experiencing. He was trying to recall, what was it that Jesus said? Something about a seed dying and then a rebirth. What was that? And then we have John. Let's look at John again. John, he's one half of the sons of thunder. Remember Jesus gave him that nickname? John and James, sons of thunder. John wanted originally, when they had a meeting with someone who disapproved of Jesus, here's John wanting to call down thunder and lightning on him. There's a good decision. He could have been a Christian today. Let's just smite them. That's one of my favorite Bible words is smite. And God smote them. It's a good way of handling people we don't like, isn't it? We'll just smite them. Don't worry about it, bringing them into relationship with Christ. We'll just smite them. John, one half of the team that says, Jesus, I want a seat at your left hand or right hand and my brother to have the other seat. John runs ahead, doesn't always discern first. He's bold, he's ambitious, he has an eye on the prize, but he too is conflicted. John ran ahead of Peter, got to the tomb first. Why did John do that? What possessed John to run ahead and then wait? Have you ever wondered, have you ever thought about being Mary or John or Peter that morning as you go to the grave? You go to that tomb expecting to find one thing and finding something different. What did they think as they ran and they saw the guards running in the opposite direction like they'd seen a ghost? Roman guards, Roman sentries were not fearful. They were fearless. What put that fear in them? Huge stone lying flat on the ground. What are Mary and John and Peter thinking? John would be the home buyer who has all of his finances arranged ahead of time. His numbers to the fourth decimal point, probably. He's probably got an engineering background. He might be the first to spot a new housing development. He's the first to begin looking, but he sits back and he waits. He wants to see. He analyzes. He observes. And then he's sold. Who are you this morning? I really do think that our faith is cyclical. We get it, and then other days we don't. We're afraid of making a rash decision and running in. We want to test the waters before we commit. And some days we run forward. We're anxious to close the deal. Other days we run in the opposite direction. Well, I thought you were doing this. Well, no, I decided to do this over here. How can we be stronger in our faith? How can we be stronger in our faith for longer periods of time? When trauma assaults our life, when what we thought we knew and expected to find is different, and tragedy assaults us. Can we still say, I have faith in God, and can we pass those good attributes on to others? See, I think this is where Mary and John and Peter help us. All three show examples of faith They didn't turn. They're just different at processing. I think we need to have a little bit of reluctance and immature faith, faith that scratches and claws for belief until it's strong enough to carry itself. Never give up. Always searching for truth. Easter morning is the truth. Easter morning is proof that all other faiths covet but can't. No other faith has a risen Savior. They all have deceased leaders. Christianity is the only faith that has a risen leader. Other faiths crave what we have. They contemplate like Mary until, like her, they say, I've seen the Lord. That's us. Have you seen the Lord? Is the tomb empty for you? Have you looked in? Have you investigated? Christianity is not a faith of mindless followers, but people who know in their heart and have a firm belief that Jesus is and was who he said. I am the Christ, the Son of the living God. This morning, not only has the stone been rolled away, but our stones have been rolled away. There are no more. The tomb is empty, and this day is different. You see, prior to Easter, our sin was still there. Prior to the first Easter, 2,000 years ago, not the celebrations after, but that original Easter, all sin was there. Yes, I know that bulls were sacrificed and doves and sheep, but there was only one way that the sin could be removed, and that was through the death of Jesus Christ in his resurrection. Prior to Easter, Satan could throw rocks at us. Today, Satan has no rocks to throw. And my apologies if in my analogies I've offended anyone with my examples of home buying, because that seems so ridiculous compared to Easter Sunday and what it represents. But sometimes the best fits don't always afford the reverence that the day calls for. I'm going to ask you this morning, are we Mary, cautiously faithful? Are we John? We're at the front of the parade and somewhat hesitant, but once we get there, we're quick to discern. Are we Peter? We rush in where angels fear to tread and still trying to put it together, still processing. In my opinion, for what that's worth, I think the correct answer is yes. We're all three of them, depending on the day and what's going on in our lives. You know, here's the deal, though. It really doesn't matter how we get to the end of the journey. It doesn't matter if we're slow processors or fast. It doesn't matter if we are hesitant at first or we go rushing in like a bull in a china shop. What matters is that we get there. Jesus Christ is risen. That is the important part. It's in our arrival that Jesus is the Son of living God, as he's Savior and Lord. And who are we? We're powerless sinners. Always have been. And that's our lot in life. We're powerless sinners. But through Jesus Christ, we're saved. There are no more stones. The stone that was rolled away so that we could see where Jesus wasn't. He wasn't dead in the tomb. The stone that was rolled away so we could know that Jesus, as God, destroyed sin and death. The stone was rolled away so that we could tell others that Christ is risen, and he is risen indeed. Hallelujah. We're going to sing verse 1 and the refrain to He Lives. Please stand. Please be seated. I want you to notice something today, how bright and colorful the chancel is. We don't always have this with all the flowers and everything. And by the way, if you have flowers, don't forget to pick them up on your way out today. But we have the communion set up, but we also have 4 new quilts. And I think they just add to the color. And I want you to look at something else. Mary's not back yet, but Mary made a new banner for us. Now, I'm somewhat talented, a little bit, but I can't do that. So I asked Mary this morning, because Mary always does this. She says, do you want a new banner for Advent or for Lent or for whatever? And I'll say, sure. And she says, okay, what are you thinking? What's that look like to you? Or I was visioning this and this and this, and we'll talk through it and put our ideas together. This time, nothing. I come in this morning, there's a new banner. And I said, Mary, when did you start this? And she said, Friday. Well, she got the idea on Wednesday. She bought the fabric on Thursday. She made it on Friday and finished it yesterday. And lo and behold, we have a new banner. And then we have these 4 quilts. So I just want you to notice, with the flowers and everything, all the color this morning. Debbie, thank you so much for those receiving them. I want to pray. Let's see if I happen to grab a good corner. I did. Lord, I pray that God's grace be upon this quilt, warmly comforting, enfolding, and embracing. May the one who receives this quilt be cradled in hope, kept in joy, graced in peace, and wrapped in love, a gift from Christian Endeavor United Methodist Church. Lord, I just thank you for the one that was here last week and needed a quilt. I pray your blessing upon him. I pray your blessing upon the recipients of these quilts and all who gaze upon them and enjoy their beauty. Lord, I pray your blessing upon the hands that made these quilts, and that you would be glorified through them. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to share this litany with you. So it's Resurrection Joy. It's in your bulletin. It's a responsive. I say, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Christ took our sins to the cross. Christ is risen. The Lion of Judah burst his chains. Christ is risen. He crushed the serpent's head. Christ is risen. By the cross, sin is destroyed. Christ is risen. By the empty grave, death is no more. Christ is risen. And I say to you, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia. Amen. Lord, I confess our sins before you this morning. Even on the way here, we could have done something that offended someone. We could have said something to our spouse or even to ourselves. We could have mumbled under our breath. What did I forget to do? Oh, yeah. I said I was going to do that, Lord. Please forgive me. Whatever it is that we have done or left undone, said or left unsaid, Lord, we apologize for the wrongs that we've done to others or where we've disappointed you. We pray that you would be with us, that you would cleanse us heart and soul this morning, that we might accept this feast that you have prepared. Holy Spirit, I call your presence here this morning to anoint this bread and this cup for our consumption, that they might be the body and blood of Christ that removes all sins from our soul. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, he raised it to heaven, gave God the Father the glory as he broke the bread and blessed it. And he said, "This is my body, take and eat." At the end of the meal, he took the cup of salvation, filled it to the rim. He raised it to his Father in heaven, and he blessed it. And he shared it with those closest friends, and he says, "This is my blood shed for you and for all mankind, so that your sins may be forgiven. Drink of this often and remember me, because this is a new covenant." And then he shared it with his friends. Today he shares it with you. And it is my blessing to invite you this morning to come as you're led, to take extra cups if you need them, if you want to share them with friends or family members. If you need it for extra strength for the week, take it with you. But it is Jesus Christ alone who has prepared this feast, and it is he who invites you to come. I just found something up on my podium, but I'm going to share this with some friends of mine. Happy Easter. I got some friends I'm going to share some goodies with. Happy Easter.
Thank you.
Happy Easter.
Thank you.
This is one of the happiest, joyful times that you could ever have in a church. Celebrating Christ's resurrection with your closest friends. I'm going to close with another story of another stone. And I promise, maybe, that we're done with stones for a while. Although we are heading into Exodus, and I'm not sure where I'm going to end up there. But Revelation chapter 2, verse 17 has a phrase. I want you to listen to this. This is Jesus talking to John in heaven, and John is writing this down. To the one who is victorious, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give that person a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to the one who receives it. So here's the coolest thing about this. In ancient days, and even through our colonial days, when we had ties with England, this is how judgments were made. So when someone was on trial, whoever the jurors were, whether they were royalty or whoever was making a decision, they would cast a stone. The white stone was not guilty. The black stone was guilty. So I think it's very important for us to understand that thousands of years ago, Jesus is talking about giving us a white stone with our name on it. And it's a name that only you will know. Only you will recognize what is on that stone. It's your new name. It's not the name your parents gave you. It's the name that Jesus, as your creator, gave you. Satan tries all kinds of tricks to have us be proven guilty. But I want you to know this week, focus on this. The verdict is in. Okay, the verdict is in. We have a white stone with our name on it. We are not guilty. We're innocent because of what Jesus Christ has done. No matter what you've done in life, you're covered. Jesus has saved us. Have a blessed and most happy Easter. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Amen.